Well, thank you very much for inviting me over to this lovely place and beautiful conference until now. Well, I'm a clinical chemist. Let me warn you, I'm certainly not a geneticist, and I'm going to talk about genetics. So the question is, are we still evolving? And let me start off with the conclusions. And I think it's very important that I read them too, so I make no mistakes. First of all, there's little evidence for widespread genetic adaptations to Western lifestyle, and that's diet included. And recent adaptations to new environments included addition of a few new genes, but notably adjustment of allele frequencies of existing so-called standing polymorphisms. And adaptation occurred to, e.g., latitude, ultraviolet, climate, but notably to newly encountered microorganisms, notably that would be zoonosis. Well, it is quite well known nowadays that evolution has speeded up since 40,000 years ago, but fixation of new genes is hampered by a still expanding world population. Western lifestyle might exert insufficient selection pressure to prevent successful reproduction to a large extent. So it is not nature, it is nurture we are talking about, it's lifestyle. So, and everybody will agree with that in this audience, you have to adjust your lifestyle to the Paleolithic genes according to the culture of the 21st century. Now let me run through evolution in a nutshell. We know that the Big Bang was about 13 billion years ago. The Earth is about 4.5 billion years old. First billion years, almost nothing happened. And we had to do with life starting up with the beginning of photosynthesis, a kind of cyanobacteria that were producing oxygen. And that oxygen was filling the air, and at a certain point it reached a concentration that was high enough to produce ozone in the stratosphere. And that was very important because prior to that there was an exposure of the Earth's crust to a lot of ultraviolet C, and that is pretty much damaging and actually kills the organisms that at that time were especially within the sea. So the building of the ozone layer was necessary in order for life to get out of the sea. And when we had a high amount of oxygen, we had the so-called Cambrian explosion, during which most of the presently existing organisms actually came into place. So let's have a look at primate evolution. Of course, we are primate. And important is that about 6 million years ago, we had a common ancestor with the chimpanzee and the current bonobo. And during that time, most of the genes that we have still today were actually built. So we talk about hominid evolution during the last about 2.5 million years. And it started off with Homo erectus. Homo erectus had a brain volume of about 400 milliliters, which is about the same as an adult chimpanzee nowadays. And it really started off the growth of the brain in that period of time. And it was about 1300 to 1400 milliliters by the time that we are facing the next step. And that would be something like the erection of Homo sapiens. Here you see the oldest Homo sapiens that we know, Homo sapiens that came from Ethiopia. It was found in the middle Awash, very close to the place where Lucy was also found. Everybody knows about Lucy. And Homo sapiens is no more than 160,000 years old. About 100,000 years after 100,000 years ago, we started to leave the spot where it probably happened, and that's the Rift Valley in East Africa, and we migrated to South Africa and all over the world, and about 10 to 12,000 years ago, we reached the tip of South America. And out of that came the five different races that we recognize today, but I will come back to that somewhat later. About 10 to 12,000 years ago, we started with the agriculture revolution within the area what we called Mesopotamia, the current Iran, Iraq, and those were the places where they have terrible fights at this moment, and you know that it spread out and it reached UK and the Netherlands about 7,500 years ago. So far for evolution, you know that already. But it is important to understand what the genetic differences between humans became and what they already were when we were talking about that time. So I'll show you about familial hypercholesterolemia, which is a favorite example of mine. I'll talk about driving forces in evolution. I'll talk about what has been selected for and how, loss of heterozygosity and the gain of private genes, increase of evolutionary speed since 40,000 years ago. And I'm going to show you some recent genomic modifications. I'm not going to talk about Neanderthals and Denisovians. I'm not going to talk about malaria, not about skin color, and end up with lactase, persistence, and salivary amylase, which are normally taken as very good proof that we have adapted to nutrients, but I'm going to tell you a completely different story later on. Okay, let me give you some information. We do not descend from Adam and Eve. That's not true. And if we would descend from Adam and Eve, they were certainly not white, that's for sure. But what happened is that Homo sapiens was erected by something like 100 people who lived in that neighborhood of the Rift Valley probably in that time. There's a lot of discussion how many people there were in those time, but let's say 1,000 to maybe 5,000. And as I already told you, that out of that came the five different races, which is actually completely similar to the location where these people actually live. So it was probably a kind of adaptations to, as Michael said, the conditions of existence and the conditions of existence at this several places. Darwin said it, but you repeated it. Where actually the place of origin of these people are. Okay, this might be the most important slide and that I have. If you take all the genetic differences of all human beings together and you adjust to 100%, then you can have a look where these genetic differences are actually located. And then you see that individuals within one population actually carry already something like 94% of all the differences. That means that all the people here in the UK together carry about 94% of all the difference that you will find across the whole world. Very important to realize that. Another thing is that populations within a single race actually do not differ more than 2%. And if you look between the races, it is about 3 to 5%. So that means that the recognition of race from a biological point of view is completely senseless, absolutely, because most of the differences will be within a population living at one place. So this has very important consequences, because most of the variation within racial groups is within racial groups and not between racial groups. That already explains the whole, actually I could stop here, because that makes it quite clear that actually the most of the differentiation. Do you want me to stop now?
Okay. No.
I don't mind.
Carry on.
Okay. Two members of the same race are likely to differ more from each other than the average member of their race differs from the average member of another race. Another thing is that most of our current polymorphisms were already present in the first Homo sapiens. Okay, and that means that what the geneticists are doing, they find a new kind of gene, so-called disease susceptibility gene. They discover it all the time. But these genes were already present 160,000 years ago. So tell me, how can, I can explain. So if those genes survived evolution until 160,000 years ago and also till about 10,000 years ago, then please explain to me, why would they cause disease today? And the only answer to that is that because we have changed the environment. We have changed the conditions of existence. So once again, I could stop here, but let me try to entertain you for the rest of the time. If you consider it entertaining, by the way. So let's have a look at familial hypercholesterolemia. I'm a clinical chemist and we screen for these kind of conditions. And there are very few of my colleagues and internal medicine physicians, etc., that would not recognize this disease as a disease that is a gene, absolutely genetic disease. We know that it is LDL receptor mutation. We discovered something like 1500 already today. You can all be screened. We also have two others that I won't go into detail. And you know probably that these people have 50 times higher chance of premature atherosclerosis. And they have LDL cholesterol levels in that order of magnitude. Homozygous, it is more than 60 millimole per liter, although it can vary very much. Now, the interesting thing about Dutch people is that they have a very good population registry. And that means that if you now find three people, A, B, and C, who have exactly the same gene, you can trace it down during within the population registry until one common ancestor in 1800. And so they were looking what happened with these three families. Well, two observations. First of all, there was completely different mortality survival rates of these people. You see that A, B, and C had different. So they were carrying exactly the same gene, but still they had different survival. That's interesting. The second thing, and that might be even more important, is that if you look at standardized mortality, you will find that actually standardized mortality of people with familial hypercholesterolemia was lower prior to 1900 than after 1900. Then it became a disadvantage. Here it was an advantage. And that makes you wonder what it is. Here you see it go down, and that's because of treatment, although treatment is still not very good for these people. Okay, so the conclusion is standardized mortality rate was lower before 1900 for these kind of people, so it was an advantage which would actually explain that it was so widespread, 1500 mutations recognized today. And if you do the same thing in animals, you do a knockout of the LDL receptor, they have high LDL cholesterol, and they're protected against gram-negative infections. And I won't go into detail, but that is probably the explanation. And three families with exactly the same LDR mutation had different survival curves. And that can be genetic, because geneticists always thinks that it is genetic, but it is probably lifestyle. So lifestyle, and we recognize that nowadays, although these people are treated with statins and everything, they still have residual risk, and that residual risk has to do with smoking, especially in men, and all these kind of things that they still do. Okay, let's have a look at driving forces in evolution. Of course, that is mutation and natural selection and adaptations to the conditions of existence. And we know that we also adapt by epigenetics and sensors, although epigenetics and sensors are also under control of genetics. So it's all genetics, what we're talking about. Now, here you see the complete list of the driving forces. You have, of course, mutation in conditions of existence, but also sexual partner selection, competition with species, competition with other species. But these are neo-Darwinian forces, and that's gene flow and genetic drift. And especially genetic drift is very important if you try to understand what the genetic difference between people at various parts of the world actually are. So what has been selected for and how? Now, I'll show you just three papers, especially from Hanok, and they say, well, we have been adapted in the last period of time for energy metabolism, sodium homeostasis, ability to digest lactose, and also starch from plants. And this I come back to later. This is another one. where they did a genome-wide association study, and there you see they come out with genes that have to do with morphology, pigmentation, and hair development. You're probably not very much surprised. Immune response, DNA repair, sensory functions, insulin regulations. Maybe Staffan can comment on that because he made a remark in that direction. And also metabolic pathways. But all of them come up with exactly the same kind of genes. And that there's quite some consistency in that. This is an important paper from Hannock where you see that he looked at climate as a factor, and he looked at people who are living underneath different environmental conditions, and he came out that pigmentation and UV radiations are of course important, and in my mind very important that he's looking at autoimmune diseases, infection, immunity and cancer, which in my mind together has to do with just infection and inflammation. And I'll come back to that later. Because it looks as if climate is very important because we sense the cold and we sense the heat. But climate comes together with something that is neglected. It is a proxy for something that we do not really understand if you're not a biologist. And that comes together with biodiversity. Because most of the biodiversity you will find around the equator. And if you go up or down, the number of species will actually decline. But that's not just species like elephants, etc. That also has to do with the bacterial flora and the microorganisms. Because if you now look at the parasitic and the infectious diseases, then you also find that around the equator they are the most present. So not surprising at all, it is more chance that you contract some kind of disease if you go to Africa compared with Sweden, for instance. Now let's have a look at loss of heterozygosity and gain of private genes. Now we do know that there has been selection on already existent allele frequencies, and I'll show you some examples of that. And there might have been some new genes, although we have exaggerated interest in those new genes because there are not many of those, and genome-wide association studies do not show them. They always come up with pigmentation and with all the evergreens that that you know, like hair growth and etc. So I'm going to show you some of those. Very well known is the altitude in Tibet. If you go to high altitude, you start with erythropoietin and you get a very high hemoglobin. And if you have a high hemoglobin, you get a stroke. That's a problem. So these people have adapted and they really got new genes in order not to increase their hemoglobin. But I won't go into detail. The way that actually the first Homo sapiens arose is via some kind of founder effects. And a founder effect is usually a consequence of a disaster. A disaster like the eruption of the Toba volcano, something like 72,000 before Christ, and it cooled down the atmosphere and there was an enormous loss. You can also think about the dinosaurs, how they actually after the impact of a meteor, they became extinct. So it's an enormous loss of genes, and if you recover you have a completely new population because you get different genes that are conserved or not. The same you get if you move out of a certain place, because if you take out marbles out of this box here, the chance is that it is not random, and we name that gene flow. And that happened during our Out of Africa movement, because it was dependent on genetic drift and gene flow, which together made a gradient from Africa to the other continents. And that has been repeatedly shown. I give you just one example. If you look at gene diversity and you are starting in Addis Ababa, where about in the Rift Valley, there you see that there is a decline of the number of genes. Actually, you get much more homozygous people the way if you move away from Africa. Another way of showing is here, where you see that the most homozygous people actually live in the tip of South America, and the most of the heterogeneity you will find in Africa. This is very important to realize. How does this compare with new genes? Well, there can only be estimates until now, and here you see an estimate that most of the genetic variation between people is not new genes, but it's actually changes of allele frequencies that were already existent 160,000 years ago. Let me give you one example where it is not true. This one is MTHFR-TT. You recognize that as people who need more folic acid, and you see around the world a much more patchy distribution, which probably has to do with the fact that those people where TT is very abundant were eating more folate. And we nowadays also have the impression that folic acid supplementation prior to pregnancy is selecting MTHFR-TT. But that's not a new gene. The gene was already present, okay? That means that everybody should fit within one nutritional guideline, because we are all Homo sapiens, unless we say, okay, MTHFR-TT is a little different Homo sapiens compared with CC. But as long as we are just one species, everybody should fit within just one nutritional guideline. Now, and you know, of course, that there is enormous disadvantage if you have this together with low folate, because here you see especially the neural tube defects, and that is, of course, enormous evolutionary pressure if you lose children because of NTDs. The same holds true for ApoA polymorphism. You know, of course, that the ApoE4 is the ancestral and has a very high chance of cardiovascular disease. And most of the people with Alzheimer's disease actually have ApoE4. And you see a very patchy structure. Nobody exactly understands what the driving force here is. You see that if you go from the equator to high up, there's some kind of U-shaped curve. And here nobody knows exactly what the pressure is. So you cannot explain everything. Here you see again that the E4 has a very high chance of cardiovascular disease compared with, for instance, E2. So out of Africa migration caused local spreading of new genes and especially some new private genes. Let me just give you one example. Here you are looking at an autosomal microsatellite that probably occurred during the crossing of the Bering Strait, and these people carried it all over the North and the Middle and South America, and it is not found anywhere. So this is quite good proof that new genes arose, but there are kind of private genes to only those people who were in the migration. Now, there was increased evolutionary speed since 40,000 years ago. We do know that if you look at proteins, for instance, that's a quite, let's say, constant mutation that you will find. And if you look at the differences and you compare with millions of years of evolution, you see a straight line. So you know that in this case, hemoglobin is evolving in a very constant way. By using this molecular clock hypothesis, you can calculate how much difference there would be between 160,000 years ago and nowadays, and that would be about 0.1%. That doesn't sound too much, 0.1% difference between the people, but let me put it in perspective. We do not differ from the chimpanzees by 1.24%, and 40% of us is similar to a worm, and you are for 50% similar to a banana. So that doesn't tell you much. Genes tell you something different compared with these kinds of figures. What is important to understand is that, of course, if you have more people, you have more chance of mutations, that's for sure. But on the other hand, there's also more chance of survival. Why is that? Just look at these fish. If this is a mutant, because of the surrounding, it has less chance of being eaten by the shark compared with the rest. So the survival of mutants is better, and there are more mutants. But there's something else, and Michael already pointed out that. And that's the enormous growth of the population since 1500. So if you have now a positive selection, a gene that is positively selected, it is very, very difficult in a very rapidly expanding population to get fixation. It's almost impossible. So maybe there are new genes, but they are private somewhere in the world that have been adapted to McDonald's, and we do not know where they are, but they are certainly not widespread all over the world. Okay, that's the, and if you look at Hawks, what he comes up with, it is still the same. It is pigment pigmentation called, etc. It's the evergreen. Everybody talks about the same genes that have been involved since then and nothing else. Now, let's go to recent genomic modifications. You know, of course, that we have been not only killing the Neanderthals, we've done something else with them as well. So especially the Europeans, they carry also the genes of the Neanderthals, and the Melanesians you will find in the Soviet genes, but I'm not going into that. It are new genes since about, let's say, maybe 40,000 years ago, at least prior to the Neanderthal extinction. But let me show you something about malaria. Now, you know, of course, that microorganisms are among the most severely selection criteria for us. We are threatened by a lot of different microorganisms. And here you select, I shall come back to that later, and there are other ones that have been named. But there are two mechanisms, once again. One of them is existing genes so that you can change the allele frequency, but the other one is mutation. Let me show you some examples of especially mutation where we adapt to, in this case, malaria and microorganisms in general. You know, of course, that malaria is widespread. It's one of the most threatening diseases that we have. Many people die from malaria, not in Western countries, because if they would be dying in Western countries, we would be investing more money into the solving of that problem. So the best thing is global warming, so that they will be confronted with malaria as well, and then we will probably find a cure. But okay, let me try to keep the line. You find it around the equator especially. And is the falciparum now a new thing? No, not at all. It is much older than the human being. But what we have been doing, and we have done that with Ebola, we have been doing it with all kinds of like HIV, etc. We have moved into the area where it was, and we were not there in the past. So we went into the zoonosis area, and we contracted all kinds of things that we were never confronted with. And here you see that there have been a lot of adaptations since malaria became widespread among human beings. And it is not only hemoglobin S. I'm going to talk about hemoglobin S, but you have to remember that there are all kinds of different ways in which we tried to adapt to the malaria parasite, because we cannot win from it. If we win from it, okay, we win. But if you cannot win, you adapt. That's what happens. And we have adapted with membrane proteins, with energy metabolism, glucose 6 phosphate dehydrogenase is the most widespread inborn error. It is an inborn error statistics. So it is not an inborn error, it's an adaptation. It's a very efficient adaptation in order to prevent dying from malaria. Hemoglobin, many of those hemoglobinopathies, I mean, in the laboratory we have a list of more than 15,000 just mutations that we know from the alpha, beta, and gamma and the delta chain. Haptoglobulin, and again, immunity, not surprising whatsoever. Okay, here you see where you find hemoglobin S. Here's hemoglobin C. This is not more than 1,000 years old. It is private to the Mossi who live there. And if you find somebody with hemoglobin C, he or she is related to the Mossi. We know that for sure. Here you see the beta thalassemias and the alpha thalassemias. I won't go into detail. Talk about sickle cell disease. At five different independent places, because we know that from haplotypes, there was mutations for hemoglobin S. And why is this such an enormous advantage? The reason is that if you look at Kenya, You see that hemoglobin AS, so the heterozygous people, children in this case, survive better compared with the wild type, whereas the SS actually die. Okay, I haven't told you that evolution is elegant, did I? I didn't tell you. Okay, anyhow, this is what we call balanced selection. You just let some of them die so that others have a better survival. And that's what we call balancing selection. Until there are too many SS, then of course it switches to the other way and you get into balance. The same holds for the blood groups. Blood groups have been selected for, probably on the basis of malaria. I won't go into the mechanism, but we know that blood group zero has a survival advantage. So the ancestral one is an absolute disadvantage, so it is removing more and more from Earth, and B has an intermediate one. And you see that if you look at zero, which is about 63% of the world population by now, you will find in South America 100% blood group zero. And we know nowadays, at least we expect that there has something to do with that. Let's go to lactase persistence, because everybody has an opinion about that one. We have also an opinion, and I'm going to try to explain. Of course, it started here. We started with the agriculture revolution, but next to the agriculture, we had, of course, the domestication of animals. And here you see how the animal domestication actually took place together with the agriculture revolution. Now, we do know that lactase persistence has arisen independently at several places in the world. There where people were drinking milk, and since it lactase splits lactose, it must be a nutrient, right? It must be a nutrient, okay. Here you see the selection coefficient. This is a very high selection coefficient, and for sub-Saharan Europeans and Scandinavians, all of them have a very high selection pressure, so that you have positive selection on this gene. So, okay, so every since it is a nutrient, it should be nutrients, one of the strongest genetic signatures of natural selection yet reported in humans. Those kind of expressions have there been. And you know, of course, that if you look at the whole world, it is patchy. All these people have been drinking milk, and they have different mutations, because this is the European mutation. You won't find that one in Africa. And everyone has his own private gene that confers lactase persistence. Now, a big surprise recently, I must tell you, I was laughing when I saw this. And you see that in the Bronze Age, something like 1,000 to 3,000 years ago, before Christ, long after the start of the agriculture and the domestication of animals, then still only one in every five of the people in Europe had that mutation. So the question now is why, if it was such an enormous selection on the basis of nutrients, why did it take something like 7,000 years in order to become widespread? That such a big selection is probably not the case, because nowadays we know that 60% and higher of the people in Europe have this selection. Now, it might not be milk nutrients at all that this has been selected, and if so, then the question is, what was the selection pressure? I'll leave it for here at this moment and go to amylase. Everybody talks about amylase, because we have more copy numbers of AMY1, that means salivary amylase, compared with the chimpanzee. And that means that we are better in digestion of starch, okay? That's true, and especially the people who have always been eating a lot of starch have more copies. So case closed. It must be starch, right? It must be starch. The problem is, of course, that also the dog had exactly the same compared with the wolf. So we domesticated the dogs, And they became also, let's say, domesticated in the sense of the AME1, because also they have more copy number variation. Okay, they have also been eating grains. Okay, that's the explanation. But that is probably not the case. And one of my PhD students came up with the following, and he asked this question: why more amylase in saliva when pancreatic amylase is an overkill? Because Stefan also said it in his talk, we have an enormous amount of amylase. We can eat even more starch if we want to. So what is the selection then? Well, the selection, he said, is not the total activity. It is the place where you hydrolyze it in your mouth and not in your, let's say, very close to your pancreas outflow. And that you understand, if you understand SGLT1 and SGLT2, not going to talk about this one, this is kidney stuff, but this is for the gastrointestinal tract. We pick up glucose by SGLT1, and that also comes together with sodium and with water. You know that, of course, because that is the point in oral rehydration salt, because oral rehydration salt is no more than sodium and glucose. You wouldn't say so if you look at the price of that thing. That's completely different. But prices in healthcare have nothing to do with, let's say, with the costs of the ingredients. But nevertheless, you see that SGL1 and dehydration come one to one. And if you now think about dehydration being in the past one of the major reasons to die, and why is that? Because you contract some kind of bacterial infection. Where will this strike? In your lungs, and especially in your gastrointestinal tract. Why? Because, well, you have to puncture the skin in order to get something in. And we are very well protected here. And we do not communicate much with the environment via our skin. But in your lungs and in your gastrointestinal tract, you have to communicate, because there you have to take up oxygen and exhale CO2, or you have to take up nutrients. And that makes you fairly vulnerable to infections. So the idea is that both the lactase persistence and also AME1 have nothing to do with the nutrients, but it has to do what is growing on those kind of foods. Let me just show you that SGLT1 is especially abundant in the small intestinal tract, but you also find something, some of those, you have blown it up a little bit, in your stomach, of course, very, very few there. Okay, if you now load to people with a high AME1 and a low AME1, if you load them with starch, you see that the people with a high AME1 react faster in their insulin and also in their glucose. So that means that if they are eating starch, that the glucose is getting into the circulation much faster compared with people who do not have many of those copies. And that it might be something completely different, that we are talking about gluten and we are talking about pathogens. And let me just explain. Gluten, mycotoxins and zoonosis might be part of and especially our adaptations to that might be part of natural ORS. So our answer is lactose and also starch, because that will especially provide us with glucose, and that means that you now can better actually take up sodium and also water and try to prevent dehydration. Now, you see here all kinds of mycotoxin, why I don't go into detail. Still a big problem in Africa. For instance, aflatoxin B is one of the big killers still in Congo, for instance, and we know that it also causes hepatoma. It is growing everywhere, but it's very well controlled in the Western countries. See how it is widespread across the world. And we have to do with zoonosis. And there are many of those. Because of time, I won't go into detail. And zoonosis is the lethal gift of livestock. If you get more animals towards you, you are getting more bacterial and other kinds of infections. And let me just show you how zoonoses are killing us. Here you see the Spanish flu, here you see HIV, and well, we know, of course, recent, if we didn't set a stop to Ebola, everybody would have contracted Ebola. Okay, that's also a zoonosis, and I can go on and on. Finally, this is a very clever molecule. You're looking at gluten. If you split it up in the different peptides, each of them will try to disrupt you. That's what's happening. And Stefan's group have actually added something new, that it also has to do something with leptin. And if you now think that we are adapted to gluten, let's just have a look at this map. Very interesting. The highest rate of celiac disease you will find in Turkey and Iran, and that's the place where we started with the agriculture revolution. So once again, I come back to the conclusions. I'm not sure if you want me to read them again, but let me just end up that our paleolithic genes are still working in us, and we have made a conflict between the environment and those paleolithic genes that have not changed, maybe except for the Homo McDonald's, who's walking somewhere around, but we haven't seen him. And this is the alternative. And I come from healthcare also, and I'm retired now, but I can say tell you I have a very good pension out of that. But it's not a very good idea that we solve everything with pills. So we have to go back. Thank you very much.
Boyd Eaton and Connor said in their paper that we had 99.9% similarity between modern man and our ancestors. What would you say that's?
Yeah, actually that's the same, but I just show you. That's based on the molecular clock hypothesis, the idea that any gene will mutate at a certain constant rate. Not all of them, for instance, histones do not mutate at all, because I mean those are very essential for the binding of course, your DNA. But some of them are not so essential. Not all of them are synonymous. Actually, most of them are synonymous. That means if you just change one nucleotide, it doesn't matter, you have the same amino acid. So, but the problem is that 0.1% doesn't tell you too much. Because we also differ with the chimpanzee by no more than 1.24%. So we have to look at specific genes, whether those have actually made us adapt better to current life. And until now, I have not seen them, and I predict that we're not going to see them, not now, not ever, never.
Okay. Thank you.
When I worked in East Africa, there was a guy called Banwell who did some studies on malnutrition and malabsorption, all sorts of things like that. But one of the things that he commented on was that when he did biopsies of the small intestine in these people who had some form of alleged malabsorption, and instead of lovely finger-like villi, they had these sort of leaf-like. And one of the interesting things about the lactase enzyme is it's situated on the tips of the villi.
The villi, yeah.
So to what extent would, you know, people who take milk be better nourished and therefore have better villi than people who are malnourished on the sort of so-called high carbohydrate-like pocho and bananas? And that they're actually, they're losing the tips of the villi. And that's why
they're
lactase.
Very, very good remark. If you look what bacteria are doing, many of the bacteria are targeting lactose.
Oh.
So the lactase, actually.
Yeah.
And that means that that then, of course, you get diarrhea.
Yeah.
So the bacteria have found the same, let's say, weak spot as we have tried to get away from the bacterial infections.
Okay.
It's the battle between species that we have to talk about.